How's my hair doing? I have some hot hair going on. What's up, everybody? I'm Elizabeth McSwan from EMAC and Hedwig, and today's video is going to be about my thoughts on the A9 Mark II and the A7R Mark IV. Here we go. This weekend I rented both the A9 Mark II and the A7 R4 camera bodies from Sony. So the first camera that I want to talk about is the A9 Mark II, and I really love shooting with this camera. There are some noticeable changes on here. I'm not going to go into all of them because I'm assuming if you're watching this video that you've seen other videos about this camera and all of the features that it has on it. So I'm just going to go over them fairly quickly, the ones that I noticed and the ones that I think are interesting. The first is the ergonomics of this camera. That's the first thing that I noticed when I picked it up, was that the ergonomics were a lot better. I don't really have a problem with the ergonomics of the A9 and the A7 R3, but this is a vast improvement, I would say. It just fits a lot better in the hand on the right side here. Also, the buttons are bigger and they're not as flush to the camera. So they're just easier to find by feel. They feel a little bit more robust, which is a great thing. Out of all of the buttons and things, the most noticeable difference between this camera and its predecessor is the joystick. And as you can see, so the joystick has this kind of raised texture to it. I personally prefer the joystick of the original A9 and the A7 R3 for that matter. I just find this one is a little bit harder to grab with your thumb because the edge around it is a little bit more rounded, as opposed to the A9, which is right here. And I don't know if you can tell, but this button has this raised edge around it. And it just makes it easier to feel and to really press the pad of your thumb up against. I like the responsiveness of that a little bit better than on the A9 Mark II and the A7 R4, but it's not a huge deal breaker. Another thing that I really like about this model is that there is now a locking mechanism on the exposure compensation button. I'm knocking all of these wheels and dials a lot when I'm kind of carrying my camera around. I should probably just turn my camera off. That would be the best way to keep my camera settings from getting a little wonky, but certainly having that locking button will help. And now we have two UHS 2 slots, which is huge. I don't know why this is such a sticking point for camera manufacturers, not just with Sony, but with others. I think that the new Canon 1D camera is finally getting the same thing where both of the slots have the same kind of speed. I just think that it's a no-brainer, especially when you're buying this camera that is built for speed, to be able to write to both cards at the same time, at the same speed, and take advantage of how fast the camera is. It's just like, why haven't we been doing this since the A9 came out? I don't know. And of course, there are other features inside the camera. Same sensor, but with a better AF system and a little bit better image stabilization. Sony really made some little tweaks here and there to make this camera overall perform a little bit better. And I know that when this camera was announced with all of its specs, that a lot of people were disappointed. We, as Sony shooters, have become accustomed to getting these cameras that are kind of revolutionary, right? With the original A9 and the A7 R3, there were these huge changes that made them just game changer cameras, at least in my opinion. And so getting a more evolutionary camera where the changes and improvements are more subtle and definitely smaller, it's easy for us to get disappointed. So I definitely think that this is a solid camera, and I had a lot of fun photographing with it. But at the same time, I don't see enough difference between this camera and my A9 to really be able to justify buying this camera. Maybe at some point I will, but right now I just have no interest in doing it. And like I said, this is a really great camera, and I'm not trying to discourage anybody who's interested in this camera from purchasing it. It can certainly help your photography, but for me personally, I just don't see a need to upgrade to this camera. There's just not enough to make it worthwhile for me. If the sensor was different, if there were more megapixels, I would definitely consider upgrading, assuming, of course, that the AF system and everything was still as fast, if not faster. All right, so now let's talk about the A7R Mark IV. Here it is. Okay, so as far as the exterior buttons and ergonomics and everything goes, this camera, of course, is the same. The major difference between this and the A7R III, and I know there are other ones, but the major difference, the one that I was the most interested in figuring out if it was right for me, was the increase in megapixels. I mean, there's a fairly significant increase here. I was also interested to figure out if the subject tracking mode on this camera was improved from the A7R III and what the autofocus system was like, if the autofocusing system was any faster than on the A7R III. And I have to say, after using the A9 Mark II, this camera was noticeably slower to acquire focus. Like really bad. It was really, really quite a difference. And that was disappointing. One thing, though, that wasn't disappointing was the subject tracking mode. Subject tracking on the A7R III is basically not usable. It jumps around way too much. And the subject tracking in this camera is significantly improved. It's actually usable. And I would say it's pretty close to the A9 Mark II, if not the same. So that was a really great thing to discover. But I have to say that other than that, I was really disappointed with the AF performance with this camera comparative to the A9 Mark II, or even the A9 for that matter. My A9 has really become my go-to camera when photographing wildlife, because even though I would say that my style isn't really action-driven, it's more bird portraiture. Birds move fast, and so even if you're trying to take their portrait, even if you're trying to get something that's not as action-y, you still have sometimes a second to be able to acquire focus on a subject, and the A7R Mark IV, in my opinion, shooting raw just doesn't get there. It doesn't cut it enough, and that was disappointing because I love all the megapixels of this camera. I just love the idea of having a 60 megapixel camera, but I just don't see myself in most situations using this camera for wildlife photography. If I was photographing something that was very sedentary, like a screech owl in a tree cavity or something like that, where it was fairly still, I do use my A7R III for that type of photography when I know that I don't have to worry about acquiring focus quickly. And of course I shoot other stuff too. I don't just shoot wildlife, although that has been my main focus recently. I do also shoot things like landscapes and macro sometimes and astrophotography. And certainly this camera would be really, really great for that. And I may at some point down the line buy this camera for that. But for now, I feel like my A7R III is very adequate for what I need. And even though it doesn't have as many megapixels as this camera does, I know that I can still create beautiful images with it. And so I feel like that is really the most important thing, is that I know that I can create beautiful images with the gear that I already have. In terms of my recommendations for other wildlife photographers who are considering these cameras, if you don't have an A9, and you're looking at possibly getting an A9 or an A9 Mark II, I would say if you have it in your budget, and the features of the new A9 Mark II really, really speak to you, to get the A9 Mark II and, you know, call it a day. It's a wonderful, wonderful camera. If you're more budget conscious and you're trying to save your dollars and you're more of a hobbyist or kind of maybe a more casual shooter, I would say that the original A9 camera is perfectly, perfectly fine. It's now a lot cheaper, of course. I just think that for most consumers that aren't pro, semi-pro, or serious, serious hobbyists, I think that the A9 is perfectly good. And I think that it's a very useful tool to capture wildlife, especially fast-moving wildlife. As far as the A7R III versus the A7R IV, the A7R IV has better value, in my opinion. I just think that if you're going to go that way, you might as well go with the largest megapixel count and the better AF system, because I do think that between the A7R III and the A7R IV, the AF system is a little bit better. It's just not as good as the A9 Mark II, or the A9 for that matter. As far as going with the A9 series cameras or the A7R series cameras for wildlife, it really depends on what you're shooting. It really depends on what is important to you. If nailing the shot is really important to you, if getting that action is important, I would say go with the A9 series. But if resolution is really your priority, if you want the ability to crop in fairly significantly, and you're willing to forego getting the shot sometimes, especially if you have to work quickly, then I would say go with the A7R IV. And these, of course, are just my opinions. My experiences shooting with these cameras could definitely have been user error to a degree, and definitely other photographers could be getting better results than me with the A7R IV. And I personally found myself just more frustrated photographing with that camera and not being able to trust the fact that I was going to get the shot. And I think that that's really the most important thing for me, was being able to trust my gear, to be able to be confident in knowing that I was going to get the shot, or at least have the best chance of getting the shot. That to me is really important, and it just motivates me even more to go out there and photograph more. If I feel like it's going to be a struggle, I'm just less likely to go out and photograph, and I don't want to do that. So those are my thoughts on the A9 Mark II and the A7R Mark IV. I hope that this video was helpful to you in figuring out which camera is right for you. Thanks so much for watching, everyone. As always, if you like this video, please give it the thumbs up. Please subscribe to my channel. Don't forget to click the bell so you know when I'm putting out a new video. You can also find me on Instagram. I've already posted some photos from my days working with these cameras over there, so you can check me out on there. You can also find me on Patreon for as little as $2 a month. You can get early access to videos like this, along with a bunch of other really cool stuff. So I hope to see you over there. And as always, everyone, take care. Happy adventuring. Happy shooting. See you later. Bye.